Good afternoon all. So in the last class of the electrical machine design, we have seen the output equation of synchronous generator, specific loadings, and how these specific loadings will affect on certain parameters of the design. Okay. So in today's class, we'll be discussing about the short circuit ratio of synchronous generator and how this short circuit ratio of synchronous generator will be having its effects on the choice of the design parameters and certain circuit parameters. Okay, so first we'll look into what is short circuit ratio of synchronous generator and how it is affecting the choice of design parameters. Okay, so we'll see short circuit characteristics. Short circuit ratio, this is SCR, nothing to do with silicon controlled rectifier. Okay, they store completely the different things. So we know that in the analytical study of the electrical machines, in synchronous generator part, we have studied the characteristics of synchronous generator, specifically open circuit characteristics and short circuit characteristics, that is open circuit curve and short circuit curve. Okay, so to find out the short circuit ratio of the generator, we need to take the help of OCC and SCC, that is open circuit characteristics and short circuit characteristics. Okay, so we know that open circuit characteristics are drawn against, or they are drawn y-axis is voltage, x-axis is field current, IF, and EA, y-axis is voltage, x-axis is field current, IF and EA, okay. As we increase the field current at a constant speed, okay, we first kept the motor, the prime mover, at constant speed, and which is coupled with the generator rotor. Now when I maintain the constant speed of the prime mover, the generator was rotating at constant speed. So by varying the excitation of the generator, I varied the generated voltage. So the excitation started from zero. The excitation of the generator started from zero, and I slowly increased the excitation. That is, I increase the field current which created the flux. So the induced EMF E is equals to BLV. Okay? Or specifically, if I can write phi into AI into L into V. E. Okay? So this flux is created by the excitation current, field current I or IF. Okay? Whereas V is the peripheral velocity of the rotor. Okay, so it means I am keeping this V constant, which is equals to V is what, pi d n by 60. So when I am providing the constant rotation to the rotor at n rpm, then my V will remain constant. At constant V, E will be generated. My area of iron is constant, length of conductor in the slot is constant. Therefore, my flux is directly proportional to phi. This is nothing but E is equals to, this equation has come from E is equals to d phi by dt, rate of change of flux, simple, as per the Faraday's law. Okay? So, as I go on increasing the field current, my generated EMF goes on increasing. My generated EMF goes on increasing. Initially, it will be linearly increasing, after that it will take a curve. So this is my open circuit characteristics. Okay. Initial part of the curve is linear, then at the later part the curve is taking the saturated shape. Okay. It will not come down actually. It will be almost going into saturation. So this is open circuit characteristics. So this is obtained by keeping the armature terminals open. I am not connecting any load to the armature, and I varied the excitation and I got this open circuit characteristics. Then short circuit characteristics is obtained by keeping the armature short circuited and observing the current in the short circuit. So that is obtained so let this be short circuit characteristics SCC. Short circuit characteristics. Now once I plot this open circuit characteristic and short circuit characteristic, I can very conveniently find out what are the field currents, okay, those are generating the rated voltage and the rated current under short circuit. It is just the question of taking the corresponding values. Okay, I know what is the rated voltage. Okay, I know what will be the rated voltage. I know what will be the rated current. So for that value of current, so the y axis is now not only for EA, it will be for also ISC, which is nothing but my IA full load. Okay, which is nothing but my IA full load. So y axis gives the value of current as well as the voltage. Voltage under open circuit, current under short circuit. Okay. So let us take these values in per unit. Let us take these values in per unit, taking the base as voltage. Okay, generated voltage as base. Now let this be 1.0 per unit. So the short circuit current intersection point here. This one per unit value of voltage and current is intersecting OCC at one point and also ACC at other point. Okay. So let consider O into F naught, O into F naught is the field current. Okay, O into F naught is the field current that is generating the rated voltage. I have normalized it to per unit. That's it. Okay, that O into F naught is the field current that is generating the rated voltage, and O into Fs is the field current that is circulating short circuit current or full load current under short circuit. Okay, that is circulating full load current under short circuit. So let this be point A and let this be point B. Okay, let this be point A and point B. Now let me form a triangle OAF0 and OBFS. And we will take a point C on the short circuit characteristics. So what this point C indicates? Okay, actually point C indicates the short circuit current. Okay, the short circuit current circulated by the field current that is generating the rated EMF of the generator. Rated EMF of the generator, or OF naught is the field current that is circulating short circuit current of OC amperes which is generating the EMF of OA volts or F naught into A volts under open circuit. This we have done in EMF method. The same thing we are simply repeating. Okay, so we'll see what it is. OF naught. Okay. Field current that generates rated voltage at open circuit. OFS, field current that circulates rated current under short circuit. So these are the two things. Now, with this data, OCC and SCC, I can now define the short circuit ratio of the synchronous generator. Okay. So short circuit ratio is given by it is the ratio of field current required to produce rated voltage on open circuit to the field current required to produce short circuit under short circuit condition. It is field current required to produce rated voltage on open circuit divided by field current required to circulate short circuit current on short circuit condition. So from the graph, OF naught is the field current that is producing the open circuit voltage, OFS is the field current that is circulating the short circuit current. So therefore I can write SCR is equals to OF naught divided by OFS. Okay. Now observe the triangles OCF0 and OBFS. They are similar triangles. Okay. OCF0 and OBFS both are similar triangles. The ratio of their sides will be same. The ratio of their sides will be same. Okay, you can write here triangles OCF0 and triangle OBFS are similar triangles. So therefore
OF naught by OFS. OF naught by OFS, I can write it as CF naught by BFS. OF naught by OFS can be written as CF naught by BFS. Okay, because we can take this ratio in similar triangles. The ratio will remain same. But what is BFS? BFS is nothing but my AF naught. So this is equal to CF naught divided by AF naught. CF naught divided by AF naught. Now what is this? Nothing but my SCR. OF naught by OFS is an SCR. Now what is CF naught? SCR is equals to CF naught divided by AF naught. What is SCR is equals to? CF naught is what? CF naught is nothing but my short circuit current. Divided by AF naught is nothing but my open circuit voltage. Okay, short circuit current by open circuit voltage, or I will write this as SCR is equals to 1 over open circuit voltage divided by short circuit current. What is open circuit voltage by short circuit current? It is nothing but my synchronous reactance. Okay, this indicates synchronous reactance divided by XS. Therefore, short circuit ratio is 1 over synchronous reactance. One over synchronous reactance. So in three ways we can define the short circuit ratio. First, short circuit ratio is nothing but the ratio of field current required to produce open circuit voltage to the field current required to circulate short circuit current. Second way, it is the ratio of short circuit current to open circuit voltage. Third way, it is reciprocal of synchronous reactance. Okay. Now with this value of synchronous reactance obtained, I can very easily find out what is the short circuit ratio. Or by choice of proper value of short circuit ratio, I can know what is the value of synchronous reactance. So both are possible. Okay. So for a given machine, synchronous reactance is constant. For a given machine, short circuit ratio is constant. For a given machine, short circuit ratio is constant. Why? Because, look here, short circuit ratio is the ratio of short circuit current to open circuit voltage. That is nothing but rated current to rated voltage. So for any given machine, rated currents and rated voltages are constant. If the power rating of the machine is constant, my rated current will be constant at rated voltage. Okay? So therefore, short circuit ratio for any given synchronous machine is always a constant. So once I know what is this constant, then I can go ahead with the design. Okay? So now we look into what are the effects of this short circuit ratio, or you can write for a given machine. For a given machine, SCR is constant as it depends on rated voltage. as it depends on rated voltage. Okay, so now we'll look into what are the effects of short circuit ratio on machine performance. SCR is equal to 1 over XS, or SCR is equal to short circuit current divided by open circuit voltage. That is just for my reference. Now next is effects of SCR. Now, first point is voltage regulation. Or you can take it as choice of SCR. Both us. Okay, because we will be actually discussing what value of SCR should be chosen, whether it should be chosen of higher value or it should be chosen of lower value. So moreover, it is the choice of SCR, studying the effects of SCR on various performance parameters. So first is voltage regulation. Now SCR is 1 over XS. So if I choose lower value of SCR, my synchronous reactance will increase. Okay, so with lower values of SCR chosen, the synchronous reactance increases. As the synchronous reactance increases, my IA into XS, okay, as XS increases, IA into XS increases, voltage regulation decreases, or voltage regulation will be poor. Actually, I should have mathematically lower value of voltage regulation, but voltage regulation will be poor. Voltage regulation will be poor. In the sense, I will be having more drop, therefore the terminal voltage will be lesser than, much lesser than the no load terminal voltage or generated voltage. So therefore, with respect to voltage regulation, I should not choose lower values of SCR. Okay, so with respect to voltage regulation, I should be choosing higher values of SCR, such that my excess will reduce or get lowered and my voltage regulation improves. This is first point. Second point, stability. See, this point stability will repeatedly come into picture, because so far in any of the machine we never discussed about the stability issues of the operation of the machine. Okay. But in case of alternator, this stability will come into picture more often, because it has to open stably with synchronizing power along with all the generators and transmission lines connected, because it is a source. So when there is a source, I expect that source to be more stable. So therefore, I should be studying the stability. Okay? So the stability limit is given by, or Pmax is given by, it is E into V divided by XS. E into V divided by XS. Now, and SCR is equal to 1 over XS. Now, if I choose higher values of SCR, lower values of synchronous reactance will result. With lower values of synchronous reactance, Pmax will increase. Okay, so if SCR is chosen of higher value, then XS decreases, then Pmax increases. Okay, So with respect to stability, my short circuit ratio chosen should be of higher value. If I choose short circuit ratio higher value, then voltage regulation will be poor. Now again a contradiction. See, whenever we are looking into design parameters, lot of contradictions will happen, and at the end we'll do some trade-off. We'll keep some trade-off between the parameters and then choose. But before that, we should be knowing what all are the parameters that will get affected and affected because of variation of various design parameters. Okay. So now, to improve stability, I need to keep my short circuit ratio of higher value. Okay. Next. Third point, parallel operation. Third point is parallel operation. Okay. See, Pmax, the same equation will come into picture. Okay. So more the value of stability limit, better is the synchronizing power. Okay. Synchronizing power and steady state stability limit are one and the same. Most of the times we consider it as one and the same. So if I have better stability limit, the synchronizing power is also better. So to have larger or better parallel operation, my synchronous reactance must be lesser and my short circuit ratio should be larger. Okay. So with SCR of larger value, my excess will decrease, Pmax will increase. Okay. This will imply better parallel operation. Better parallel operation. Now what happens if I choose lower SCR? One thing is clear, if I choose higher SCR, better parallel operation. But with higher SCR, okay, there may be other difficulties also. Okay. So now, if I choose lower value of SCR, okay, if I choose lower value of SCR, then my synchronous reactance increases. Now if SCR is of lower value, my excess increases. We know that the synchronous generators are connected in parallel with the transmission lines, in parallel with many other generators through transmission lines. Now if the reactances of the transmission lines will also get added to the generator, in case of say suppose open circuit, if the reactance is get adding to the generator reactance, then already the synchronous reactance is large, there is additional reactance adding to the synchronous generator. Okay, then if there is large synchronous reactance, the parallel operation performance is lower. Now two generators which are operating parallel are very weakly linked to each other. They are very weakly linked to each other. If they are very weakly linked to each other, then any variation in the load can make those two generators come out of synchronism. They can make both generators to come out of synchronism. So with respect to parallel operation, I should never be keeping my short circuit ratio to a lower value. Okay, I should never be keeping the short circuit ratio to be at lower value. Okay. So fourth point is short circuit current. Fourth point is short circuit current. we can see from this equation SCR is the ratio of short circuit current to open circuit voltage. So with larger value of SCR, my short circuit current will increase. Okay, increase in short circuit current means what? Decrease in synchronous reactance. Okay, with large value of short circuit ratio, large value of short circuit current will be there. There will be smaller value of synchronous reactance, because synchronous reactance is what? It is the ratio of open circuit voltage to short circuit current. So synchronous reactance is inversely proportional to short circuit current. Therefore, it will be directly proportional to short circuit ratio. Okay. So we will be having better short circuit current. But there is one danger is that if the short circuit current is large and if the short circuit condition prevails for long time, then it may cause damage to the system. That is one more disadvantage. Okay, if larger value of SCR is chosen, short circuit current increases because lower value of synchronous reactance is there. This synchronous reactance implicitly controlling the short circuit current. Now under short circuit, if so synchronous reactance is very low, then my short circuit current will be large, and if it exists for long time, okay, if it persists for long time, then there may be a physical damage caused to the alternator. So therefore, this is one of the slightest disadvantage with respect to the SCR choice. Okay, so these are the parameters which we consider. Okay, which we consider for the choice of short circuit ratio. Okay, choice of short circuit ratio. Okay. So next we will move to the main dimensions and design of salient pole machine. Okay. Design of salient pole machine and main dimensions. Salient pole machines in that main dimensions. Okay. So we know that all the salient pole machines are. So this is a salient pole rotor. This is a salient pole rotor, and this is one pole. Okay. This is one pole. This is one pole. This is called pole core. This part, rectangular part what you are seeing, it is called pole core. This curved part is known as pole shoe. Okay, this is pole core, this is pole shoe or pole face, both are same. Now this is the width of pole shoe, this is the length of pole shoe. Okay, so this is the width of pole shoe and this is the length of pole shoe. Okay, so when I want to choose the pole, first I need to select what shape of pole must be considered or chosen. This pole what you have seen is a rectangular pole, because you can see it is a rectangular pole. See here, it has got one side, plane side, another plane side. So this will form a rectangular pole. Okay. But we know that with rectangular poles, there is a difficulty in keeping the winding on it, because there are sharp edges on all the four sides, and those sharp edges may cause physical damage to the coils or to the turns. So the ideal cross section for any core is always circular or cylindrical. Okay. Now first we'll see what is cylindrical pole or the types of poles. First we will see the types of poles. First is round pole or circular pole, same. Second is rectangular pole. Now we'll see how the round pole looks like. First one is round pole. This is how a round pole looks like. This is how a round pole looks like, where this is the length L. And this is the width. BS is breadth of pole shoe. Okay, BS. So the cross section of the pole is round here. The cross section of the pole is round. Okay, so this is the round pole. Rectangular pole will be like this. This is the rectangular pole. Okay. So this is the length L. And this is the width of pole shoe. This is the rectangular pole. Okay. Where the pole is rectangular. This rectangular pole is exactly like this. Okay, you can observe this is a rectangular pole. Okay, this is width of pole shoe. Width of pole shoe BS. This is the length L. This length L is nothing but the main dimension. Okay, it is the length of stator bore itself. So for round poles, I will just rub this part up over here. ground pole. So for round poles, there are certain relations. The ratio of polar to pole pitch. Polar is nothing but the pole shoe itself. Polar and pole shoe both are same. Okay. For round poles, polar to pole pitch ratio. This is equals to 0.6 to 0.7. Okay, that is BS to tau p is equals to 0.6 to 0.7. Now, if the poles are rectangular, if the poles are square, if we use square pole shoe means what? This length and this width will be equal for square pole shoe. BS will be is equals to L. Therefore, L by tau p is equals to 0.6 to 0.7. 0.6 to 0.7. Okay? That is equals to, or that implies L is equals to 0.6 to 0.7 into pi d by p. This is with round poles. This is with round poles. Now with rectangular poles, I have to draw this. I will just draw this part. So again, for rectangular poles, polar to pole pitch ratio. Ratio is from 1 to 5. It is between 1 to 5. Okay. Generally, this polar to pole pitch, that is BS by tau p, generally this BS by tau p is less than or equal to 3. If it exceeds 3, the system becomes uneconomical. It becomes more costly. Okay. The machine becomes more costly. Okay. And with square pole shoe, BS is equals to L. Therefore, L by tau p is equals to 1 to 5, or L is equals to 1 to 5 into pi d by p. Okay? 1 to 5 pi d by p. So we can see here the diameter of rectangular pole machine will be larger than the diameter of round pole machine. Diameter of rectangular pole machine will be larger than diameter of round pole machine will be larger than the diameter of rectangular pole machine, because see, 0.6 to 0.7 is less than 1, that will come into the denominator. D is equals to L divided by 0.6 to 0.7. So it will be greater than 1. It will be less than 1. So therefore, diameter with round poles will be more, hence the machine becomes more costly. So round poles, it is difficult to achieve the laminations. That is one mechanical difficulty. Second, economically, this is not feasible. Okay. So therefore, we generally go with rectangular poles. Okay. So with rectangular poles, I will be considering the centrifugal forces and peripheral speed. If I limit the peripheral speed, my centrifugal forces will be automatically limited. Okay? So with rectangular poles, or before that, we will see how the projected poles are fixed to the magnetic wheel. This is the magnetic wheel. This is magnetic wheel. These are externally fixed. This is not a single cast. This is not a single lamination we are using. Okay. So these poles are separately prepared with laminations. Then they are fixed on this magnetic wheel. Okay. So now, how the fixation is done? There are two ways how I can fix these two. So one, take a heavy magnetic wheel. This is a magnetic wheel. Okay. Then connect the poles or fix the poles using the bolts. You can fix the poles using the bolts. Okay? This is one pole, one more pole. Okay? So using bolts. This is bolt fixation. There can be fixation using dowtail. Okay. Dowtail fixation we can have. So this is the magnetic wheel. Okay. So I will fix this using the dowtail fixation. Wedge shape fixation. Okay. So this is the dowtail fixation. You can see. So it will be fixed along the length and it won't come out. This is dowtail fixation. Okay. Another type is T-head fixation. Another type is T-head fixation. This is T-head fixation. You can observe here. This type of fixations most of the time you might have seen in carpentry. Okay? So this is T-head fixation. So if there is bolted fixation, then the peripheral speed limits I am keeping little bit low. Then if I am using the T-head or dowtail, then peripheral speed limit I will be keeping little bit high. Okay? So with bolt fixation, my peripheral velocity is less than or equal to 50 meter per second. Okay, less than or equal to 50 meter per second. With this both, it is my V less than or equal to 80 meter per second. So with dowtail and T-head fixations, I can go little higher with the peripheral speeds. So even if there are slightly larger centrifugal forces exerted on the rotor poles, it is fine with me this kind of fixation. But this is dangerous with the larger centrifugal forces, because there may be a tendency that these bolts may get loosened and the flyout of the poles may occur. So that, to avoid that, I will be keeping this at lower speeds, and I can achieve some larger speeds with dowtail and T-head fixations. Okay, so this is T-head fixation. You can observe it is a T shape, it is a dowtail shape, that is the reason. Okay. So this is all about the today's session. In next session, we will be dealing with the further part, and we will see some examples on wind dimensions. Then we will move with the armature design. Okay. So thank you for joining the class.